One of the difficulties in discussing sexual abuse and how horrendous it is and the impact that it has on those who've been victimized is that if one describes graphically the tragic consequences in various cases, it may frighten people off from being associated with survivors of abuse. They may say these are damaged goods. I don't want my daughter to marry this young man, my son to marry this young woman. I should stay away from their families. Who knows what's been going on? And that's a problem. Properly helped and supported, many survivors go on to have full lives. Just the other day, I attended a remarkable wedding of a survivor of abuse. But I will tell you that what made the wedding possible and so joyous was that he had been supported by his parents the entire time, even though it made their lives very difficult within the section of the Orthodox community where they live. There are statistics about people being abused. Say that 1/4 of the population had suffered an event of being abused, 1/3 of women, 1/6 of men, sometime in their lifetime. And understand that some people have one experience, but in many cases, the abuser, who's perhaps a member of the family, an associate, a teacher, a rabbi, a friend, may repeatedly abuse the same person tens if not hundreds of times. And the individuals who have been abused are vulnerable to be abused by other people as well. What about the Orthodox community? We like to believe we're different. Let me tell you about the one attempt I know to get statistics about abuse in the Orthodox community. A group of 5 women psychologists, I think they were all Orthodox women, decided to make a study, not about abuse, but about the effect of going to the mikveh on satisfaction in marital life. But in order to do a proper study, one has to factor out other considerations. Obviously, it's people who have been abused, people who have physical or mental illnesses, affects their married life as well. So in order to do the study properly, one of the questions they asked, taking the standard that had been used in national studies, to ask the women, it was only about women, of whether they had been abused at any time in their life. And the result of their study was that the percentage of Orthodox women was essentially exactly the same as everyone else. And they presented these results at a meeting of the Orthodox Forum, a think tank of some of the really brightest minds in the Orthodox community, rabbis and professors and experts, and everybody doubted their statistics. They came up with many arguments to prove that their methodology was incorrect, their criteria was inappropriate, absolutely rejected it totally. They were so upset, they actually didn't print it in that volume of the Orthodox Forum when it came out, so they printed it elsewhere. I was given the assignment of responding to the report. So I went and I asked a number of prominent psychologists and psychiatrists about it. And the comment I got was, "Ho-hum, of course it's the same. There's no change in this report whatsoever. It's a problem throughout society. It is not determined by educational background, ethnic background, wealth, or poverty. It's everywhere and essentially in the same numbers." The one other attempt that I know was a study a friend of mine did in Israel, which he did within the Haredi community, and he put it back to me, though I haven't seen this published either, was he has bad news and good news. The bad news is that the percentage was the same as the secular community. The good news was that it wasn't worse, because there are particular problems within the framework of our community. Why, if the problem is so prevalent and our statistics are not different from anyone else's, why do we have such a difficult time in responding to it? The first explanation is we don't want, and we find it very difficult to believe that which I just told you. That was the responsibility experts who were there at the Orthodox Forum. It couldn't be true. There must be a mistake in methodology. Why? Because we believe that people who are brought up and follow the dictates of the Torah are obviously much better people because of it. And therefore they could not, with rare exceptions, do anything as horrific as abusing children. So it can't be true. Of course, there's a difference in this respect between the Haredi and the modern Orthodox community. But before you feel better, mainly the modern Orthodox community, the difference is only in theory. In the Haredi community, there are people who still tell you it never happens or it's very rare. In the modern Orthodox community, they will acknowledge that it occurs theoretically. But when it turns out to be someone that they actually know, and he or she doesn't look any different than anyone else, they say, in this case, it can't be true. So in theory, there's a difference. In practice, it's essentially the same. Just take a couple of moments on the religious arguments that are always used in not responding. By now, everyone's familiar with them. It's Mesira. Mesira is a term that strikes a very powerful chord. A Moser was a traitor to the Jewish people who took their fellow Jews to the secular, often anti-Semitic government, and was seen as something horrendous. The Aruch HaShulchan, already in over 100 years ago, said that it does not apply in a democratic society, which is not anti-Semitic, which is essentially fair. And though I didn't hear it directly, I've seen numerous sources that the Rav that's all felt the exact same way. But even those who disagree all agree, and this is true, this from Rabbi Yosef to many, many other the poskim, that if there is a situation in which the perpetrator is an ongoing danger, and we cannot deal with the problem internally, then clearly one must go to the secular authorities to have the person put away. I'll spend a couple of minutes explaining why we can't deal with the situation internally. I don't think it should be necessary to point out that abusers are an ongoing danger. Personal notice, I was involved in a situation quarter of a century ago, where, without going through the full story, an abuser was sent to a very capable psychologist. And I was told a few months later that the psychologist said, you don't have to come anymore. I called the psychologist up and I said, amazing, you cured this fellow in a few months? He said, no, I can't cure him at all. Let's understand, he's now in his late 40s, the libido isn't the same as it was when he was young. There's been scandal about him, everybody knows, he's no longer a danger. He was wrong. Terribly wrong. I was part of a medicine that dealt with a case of abuse 25 years ago, and it's probably the reason why I've been so active ever since. It was a good medicine. The Rabbanim were honest, but I can't talk about myself. The other two Rabbanim were people of stature. They set ground rules that seemed to make sense. And we did not succeed in dealing with the situation without going into details. Why not? We didn't understand the situation well enough. For example, one of our ground rules was we were going to deal with cases that took place in the last 10 years. 10 years, that's a lengthy time. Most people were abused when they were young, including adolescents, cannot come forward within 10 years. They're not strong enough. They haven't gotten professional help and support. It takes them more than that. So we missed out on the people who were capable to come forward. We didn't know the fact that a certain category of abusers, one that one reads about and will continue to read about, unfortunately, are very charismatic leaders who can get people to support them and lie for them. People who had never lied before Beis Din lied to us because they felt the loyalty to the person, even people who themselves had been abused. Just recently, and it's still going on, there's a case which has gotten some publicity, but only in people who read blogs, involving a head of seminaries in Israel. And this was done, was dealt with by people who say, don't go to the police, and went to the only Beis Din that exists in the United States, specifically the special Beis Din that is set up to deal with cases of abuse. The Beis Din has been in existence for 14 years, very prominent Rabbanim across the spectrum of the Orthodox community, and they found the man guilty. And they found out that people who worked for him, staff and administrators, had enabled, and they covered it. A parent called, and had been told by the parent's daughter, and they brushed the parent off. Students were told they should not cooperate, they shouldn't talk, otherwise they'd be guilty of lashon hara, and they wouldn't get a shirt. And it's now in the stage of a dispute between what they did, and it's still very much up in the air. So even when the victims, the survivors, followed the dictates of the community, went to a Beis Din, the Beis Din was serious, the Beis Din found the person guilty, it still didn't solve any problems. And I don't know how that situation is going to end up, to tell you the truth. Does that mean there's no role for rabbis at all? Not true. Rabbis can be very helpful. However, many rabbis are not. First of all, I went to yeshiva and studied for smicha. I never heard a word about it. There was nothing in my training. The only thing that did not involve actual learning of your day and sechtos was training in giving a sermon. That was practical rabbinics. And this practical rabbinics, giving a sermon, conducting the wedding, well, it's not conducting the funeral, but this kind of area was not discussed at all. It's now being taught to rabbinic students, but obviously that's irrelevant to the vast majority of rabbis. So some rabbis have picked it up, and they're sympathetic, and they're understanding, and it can be very helpful. Not in replacing the police, and not replacing therapists, but being people who support the victims, support the families, and can help them in terms of the community at large. I don't have a list. I assume that you should be able to tell rather rapidly which rabbis in your community can be helpful and will be helpful, and those who are. Unfortunately, I don't want to take this away from Shira. Shira helped organize a program that was just announced by Yeshiva University of training of rabbis. And the last I heard, and hopefully it's changed for the better, so few rabbis signed up that they're probably going to cancel the program. Right? Rabbis don't feel it's important enough to be trained in this area. What about non-rabbis? Plain old Balabatim. You also have an incredibly important role. Very simple. I don't want to ask people to raise their hands. I assume that many of you sent your sons and daughters to camp this past summer. How many of you asked the camp whether it trains its staff, what its procedures for dealing with abuse? Could ask the same question about the schools you send your children to, and I think, you know, even more so about the yeshivas and seminaries in Israel where you're sending your children 6,000 miles away for a year, and they're not asked the question by very many parents. I don't have to embarrass anyone against statistics. People don't ask. Well, if you don't ask, why should the camps take it seriously? Parents don't seem to care. When there are scandals, the schools don't lose any students, the camps don't lose any campers. The community is sending a powerful message of indifference. And that, of course, has impact. Because all the work that's done to create proper procedures and training gets wasted when it appears that no one cares. But it doesn't make a difference to anyone. I'm about to conclude, but I just want to mention that which is so difficult that I really have very little positive thing, good things to say. And that is that most abuse is not the outsider, it's not the educator, it's not the rabbi, it's not the doctor abusing patients, it's a family member. To use the ugly word, it's often incest. And in the family situation, it's extremely complex. Family members have to choose loyalty between the older brother and the younger sister. Does a family want to take a family member and bring them to the police? The brain breaks and the trauma for the family is incredible. I know the right answers, but I know how hard it is for any family having to deal with it to really not just be stopped in their tracks and actually do that which is right, though very difficult. The only people that I know who are capable of evaluating accusations and determining whether there was abuse, the degree of the abuse, the only people that are trained are the police. And that is the only people we can go to, no matter how difficult it is. And there are consequences of going to police, of course. There are also consequences of how the community reacts to those who have the strength to go to the police. The victims need support. They, of course, they need therapists. But not all therapists are experts in this area. When you go to a doctor, if you have a broken leg, you don't go to a heart specialist. You have to go to those therapists who are trained in this area. And there's very little of that going on in the graduate programs. Not in the social work schools, not in the psychology schools, not in the medical schools, you train psychiatrists. Because not enough people in the society have said it's important to train people appropriately. I want to end where I started. I can't imagine anything more devastating, potentially dangerous to the victims than having been abused, particularly by someone they respect. If it's done when they're very young, their ability to distinguish, to have healthy marriages is diminished. And because there's no physical signs, right? There are no bruises. They don't look like they're damaged. At the same time, I want to end with the wedding I went to. There are survivors who find their way. Many of them do so by being active in the cause themselves. It gives them something that they've learned from this terrible experience. But don't just see them as damaged goods. See them as people that we have failed, but that failure need not be permanent if we change our attitudes as a community and as an